Hello, I'm the Wandering Newbie, and it's time for more Record Keeper. Today, we have the Final Fantasy III event for the Onion Knight. Now, this is such an interesting event, an interesting character, because the whole theming of the event is powering up. It's getting, like, good equipment. They have these EXP dungeons. The Onion Knight himself is bad until you hit level 93, which is accurate to the character. And then these experience dungeons are all fighting dragons, which in the original FF3 dropped the Onion Knight gear. So it's just good theming all around. Anywho, first up we got the boss rush, which again is sort of theming around, Eureka? Yeah, Eureka. The Lost Land of Eureka, which is Doga and Une, who are the guardians of Eureka. And at this point in the story, they demand that the Warriors of Light strike them down in order to take the key and unseal the seal. Now, we won't be seeing much of him for now, but we will be seeing more of the Onion Knight later. I'm saving him for a special moment in the stream later. But anyway. For the overarching effects of this fight, you want some heavy-hitting attacks, but you also need magic breakdowns, Shelgas, and Dispels, because they like to buff themselves and they like to throw out a lot of magic attacks. So, you know, we put a party together resembling that. I have recruited some Onion Knights, as you can see. They're good. And actually, I see a Mighty Guard there, so I'm just going to switch Arc over to Protectia and snag that Mighty Guard. Yes, the experience dungeons drop the motes that you need to unlock the Onion Knight, which is fantastic. Onion Knight is a very odd character, as he takes a lot of investment. But if you invest in him, he's fantastic, actually. Just covers a lot of bases and has extremely good stats on top of that. But again, needs a lot of investment. Yeah, we'll be seeing a lot of the Onion Knight burst later. So, Doga and Unin, something like that. they're pretty similar fights, as I said. Both like to throw out a lot of magic damage and utilize buffs and the like. Just lower the magic, put up a Shelga, you'll be pretty good. Now they resist earth damage, but I'm not doing that for the damage. Doing that for the buff. Of course, I've never shown off Blood of the Dragoon, or Blood of the Weverin before. A fantastic ability that removes the jump time from jump attacks. Never really been able to fit it on a character, because usually it was like, ah, I need them to do a jump, and also this other thing. Oh, Desh, I still love you. Underappreciated, really. And really, Chain Thundaya works really well in this realm, since we have that nice free magic rod, the light rod, that boosts lightning damage. I think Une here is the one that's more, it's more common to buff. Yeah, there you go. Already starting up. We'll probably want to let Ignis get a turn and dispel that before we start going really whole hog with our physical attacks. Desh is alright. Desh is a very standard black mage. I just kind of love him because while I don't have a lot of them, his soul breaks are fantastic. Really just supreme animations on them. The one actually dropping, I think, on the second banner is super good. And of course, the nice thing about dispelling buffs is if you dispel them, boss is very likely to recast them. Just waste turns. That's it. A fairly simple boss rush, mainly because they deal one type of damage. So you just bring a Shelga, magic breakdown, and you're pretty solid. Pulling on the second banner, that's a hard choice. It really matters on how much you got from the first one. If you got a good bit from your draw on the first one, then yeah, probably pulling on the second one is better, because you're less likely to get a dupe. While a dupe does give you an extra stat stick or a bigger stat stick, it's nice to get different breaks. Eureka level 2. So this is the ninja, who, right here, this little line right here. His physical attacks may inflict blind and poison. That is extremely annoying, but luckily, susceptible to slow. We're not actually going to be changing our setup all too much. Again, there aren't actually a lot of Final Fantasy III characters. But we are going to be taking a Taunt and a Sloga. And we're going to see if we can't find a Lunatic High Roaming Warrior. I want that Haste and I want that Protect. I know I got one somewhere. I used to have a bunch, but they've really kind of fallen off, and really, there aren't... Like, the more and more I think about it, there was never really a super big replacement for, Lunatic High, the same way that we got Mighty Guard and everything like that. Oh, Onion 2. Now, again, the Lunatic High will be extremely useful because most of the things that the ninja does is physical. Our taunt should deal with the most of that, holy crap. But he does have an AoE, and we do want to slow him immediately because he moves extremely fast. Look at that shit. He got off two turns before I had a chance. Luckily, we've just doubled our turns and halved his, so. And now Ignis will be taking the brunt force of all the attacks. And everybody else can just, heal or do damage as they see fit. It was what? 12k? A little bit over, probably taking the 7s, a 14k. Let's see how much Chain Thundaga does. Yeah, that's the move I was worried about. That's why I wanted the Lunatic High. No surprise, Meltdown is still more damage. How is my good boy coming along? He's alright. We might see more of him later. The good boy. Lunith still pulling in 12k plus damage, no boosts. Lightning Dive was a good investment. Yeah, kind of funny that this ninja is so physical based, and yet your normal record keeper ninja is actually very magic based. But really, there are two physical ninja moves, just nobody uses them because they're not worth it. One of them was. There was a very short period of time where Shadow Steel was super good, as it could inflict sap, and there were two ultimates in a row that were vulnerable to sap. And then that stopped. Ah, the good move. Anyway, but first, we have to dig out Hecatoncheir. Hecatoncheir, being the Earth Guardian, mainly physical, but does have one very spicy magic attack. So you do actually want to bring a mixed mitigation. Well, you know the EXP dungeons drop The EXP dungeons drop. God, hold up, my brain stopped. EXP dungeons drop motes. Holy crap. Woo! This should be showing it, right? Yes. Okay, good. Anywho, Hecaton, as stated, is a very mixed person. So we do want to actually mix up our moves as well. And I think now it's time. Tall Geese. One of the very few situations where I had some, I followed somebody for a specific roaming warrior and they switched and I was like, nah, you know what? That's fine. I can always find more. For reference, I followed them for Fenrir Overdrive because that's really good for farming. Yeah. The onion moats. Like I said, the XP dungeon does drop those. And that's where I've been spending most of my time. I've gotten quite a few. Feels like that should have had a sound effect of some sort. Now, I don't think I've ever used those before. While they have a very weird effect and the thing just says raises resistance, that is actually just glorified Shelga. It's Shelga on a bard. Bards can cast Shelga. It's the thing that a lot of people actually think about sometimes. Ah, here we go. That's a 30% attack and magic boost, which means it stacks. Let's see what a 30% buff comboed with Dark Bargain activated with Lightning Drive does. Lightning Dive. We're already seeing, you know. Oh god. So good, both of those. Just disgusting. Chain Thundaga actually doing the least damage, but it's only one move as opposed to a bunch. Like that's 16,000 damage, no buffs outside of just the summon. Onion Knight is the best ninja because he can use rods. Alright. We got a bit of time. And I need to take a bit of a side trip. Oh, wait, hold up. You make the night better. And it's time for me to get the final piece of the puzzle. Right here. Yeah, let's just use that. If I wait a moment, I can get it. Who cares? So I'm just gonna crank the speed up to 5. Hit this button on auto. Welcome to farming. Yeah, the AXP dungeons have a chance to drop motes. I need to run through this to get the Onion Knight's third memory crystal. Not to mention, gives a fair bit of EXP, and that's great for mastering any breaks that you may have picked up. Okay, that was a big dip there for a moment. My Wi-Fi is acting up really bad, so I'm gonna start this last fight and bounce the router real fast. Sorry about all this. Thank you. Oh, that's right, it's gonna give me a connection error all in the fight. Whoops, didn't even think about that. Let's just finish that off. Yeah, I forgot that, killing the connection during a fight is gonna cause that to happen. This seems to be much stabler. Much more stable, stabler. Whatever. It's fixed. Anywho. Now, we execute plan Good Boy. Wait, what the hell is that? Is that armor? Oh, it's a shield for Ignis, okay. How did the Black Friday pool go? Pretty okay. I got, 2 new bursts and a dupe. What did I get? I got Jekt and Wox, and I got a dupe of, Alright. Slight hiccup there. I don't think that's gonna reflect on the rest of the stream. What was I saying? I got Locks, I got Jex, and I got a dupe of Squalls. So, pretty alright overall. Alright, first things first. Ooh, Barts and Fangs are really good, and Balthier's is pretty good situationally. So, let's see. First things first. Gaia Cross. We're gonna make that a sweet rank too. And now, Operation Good Boy. Optimize. Not that good. Stats still kind of not all that fantastic. Next set. Optimize. Wow, only 2 points of defense. Still not all that great. Break that level half again. Oh, nope, not Lunith. We already maxed him out. Okay. A number of eggs for still not all that good of a boost. Oh, Flame Fossil's fantastic. Congratulations on your pretty good break, boy. Alright. The final breaking. And now. So, let's optimize and let's just show this off. Alright, so 92. Right? Still not that great. Bam! Now, the one thing, and this was also stated, I stated earlier in the video, major weakness, his ability access is all 3 stars, but we can fix that another way. With these. Where he at? There he is. I'm just enjoying myself here. Let's see how many more of these nodes we can really take advantage of. Just really get some good stat boosts on him. Because the thing is, he can be, once you unlock the nodes you need, we can utilize him in nightmares, such as celerity and combat and so on and so forth, and that's honestly pretty fantastic. So let's get all of the, the top nodes done, and we'll see where that leaves us later. Just because these top nodes will also give him a bunch of health and resistance and what have you. I think for the bonus battles, I plan to be using him more as a support. So I may invest him towards the support stuff, or attack, the melee stuff, and use the extra nodes, or motes that I get later, to invest him towards, what's it called? Magic. Like, look at that. Right there, that's just 18 attack, waiting for me to take it. I didn't get his Berserk Soul Break. I just think he's a fantastic character. I only got Arcs Super off that draw. And Black Friday, I got Jetlock and a dupe of Squalls. So I did pretty fantastic on that, all things considered. There we go. There's my beautiful boy. Look at that. My beautiful invested boy. Alright. Now that Operation Good Boy has been taken care of, let us continue. So, the first boss that we're going to be up against is a red dragon. We've been fighting a bunch of these in the Enigma dungeons, but this one's going to be pretty boosted, and the biggest takeaway from this fight, and the thing that actually makes him pretty challenging, is resists fire, ice, lightning, earth, wind, water, and holy damage, so that means if you want to go elemental, you have to resort... Dark and poison. Luckily he doesn't blind with his physical attacks. Why are 4-star motes so hard? They wanted to make them a challenge to get, though pretty soon they're gonna be multiplayer. For now, though. Shall we? So, I obviously prepped these teams before I was able to actually fully kit out the good boy. But now I can. Look at that! Look at this ability access! It's fantastic! So proud of my good boy. Actually, what market material does he have? Alright. He has 30% daggers, so we'll give Onion Knight the increased support damage. So, it's with an out of realm weapon. You know, if I wanted to go, like, full ham on him. God. Just fucking disgusting. Anywho. So now you would think, oh, Nobi, you're gonna use, the Onion Burst for... Actually, no. I'm not using Onion... okay, here's the deal. Onion Burst is fantastic, I won't deny that. It's used best in split parties. If you're going in entirely melee like this set up, then Shout is still the way to go. Nice thing, though, is if you have native Shout, it stacks with the burst, with the onion burst. So, fuck. You know? Thank you. For mind users, no. Sheep Song is for magic. There is the Sheep Song. Well, kind of. It's not. It doesn't have haste on it, but what's it called? Selfies burst increases mind and magic, which is acceptable. You do need something on top of that. Anywho, though. Whoop, we're still on battle speed 5. Now, the red dragon does use mostly magic-based attacks. So, and a lot of them are single target. So, a magic lore on somebody with a Gigas armlet is extremely useful for that. He has a physical attack, but he doesn't actually use it all too often. He uses it right at the beginning to, like, tag you, and then that's about it. After that, it's all AoEs and the like. So he becomes a pretty big headache. Though it seems as if our shout boost and everything might just be enough. Onion Nut. I feel like you shouldn't be seeing a support hitting that hard. Then again, there's always Onion Knight. Yeah, if you have a good break on them, throw the Lionheart record materia on that person and they will build break so fast. That's disgusting. Go home, Lunith. You're illegal. That is with a synergy weapon, so to be somewhat expected. What's his attack at? Pretty fucking high. That's the answer. Way over the soft cap. Oh, that's right. Protector's Roar does give a mind buff. Trying to see if I don't even need to recast Shout. This dragon moves exceptionally slow. This fight feels a little unfair, actually. Wait a minute. Huh. Well, I got that. now I just need one more. Because, this next fight actually gives a moat. See? But this fight is, Crystal Guardians. All of them. You fight them sequentially. You start with, Tortoise, then Salamander, then Kraken, then Titan. Tortoise is mainly physical. Salamander has some magic attacks. Kraken also has some magic attacks, including Tsunami, which is a pretty rough, as well as being able to blind your party. And Titan is very rude and has Flare and Quake. Protectika, Shelga, highly recommended for this set. As well as some other things, and we'll see that in a second. Okay, so. Let me just finalize a couple of things before I start talking strategy. You're supposed to have magic down. That didn't save properly. And then this is supposed to be Gaia Cross. And then we'll put the support breaker material on you. Solid. Okay, so. Going through each fight sequentially, what the general strategy is. Ignis will start the first fight off with Gaia Cross, and as will Rafa spend that first fight casting two Meteor Smashes. Onion Knight will be doing his normal debuffs. Selphie will cast Protectika, then Shelga, because again, the Tortoise is mainly physical. And Terra will be casting our Onion Knight Roaming Warrior, and then start with the Blazaja Chains. She'll keep doing that until the need to cast it again, which might be done by Rafa, mattering, Rafia, mattering on how many, casts of whatever are left. The ice should do extra damage against the Salamander. We don't actually have bonus damage for the Kraken, but the Kraken actually has the least HP. We're saving Meltdown for Titan, because it will have weakness against him. Hopefully we hit quad nines with it. Our stats are pretty high. I'm slightly worried about this fight, to be honest, but I think we're as prepared as we're going to be. There's a lot going on in this fight, and the boss rushes are always kind of rough. There's going to be a big game of hitting with our debuffs each time a new boss forms. To say I'm a slight bit nervous on this is maybe not stressing it enough, I think would be the better way of saying it. I was going to say underestimating it, or under-expressing it, but yeah. Because pretty much, you know, I think, I don't know. again, whoever casts that second break really matters on who has ability casts left. Because if, say... This is right. Why do you have Onion Knight 1? Should be 6. Must have clicked the wrong picture. Because if Terra runs out, she's done. Just plain and simple. Yes, that did say 517 mine. Good, exactly who I wanted to be first to cast that. Yeah, that's a meaty hit for a back row. We'll probably need Ignis to refresh his Gaia Cross on, say, right before Kraken and then right at the start of Titan. That's the kind of shit I'm talking about, though. Alright, that's one down. Yeah, see, that's what should happen. Hell yeah. Refresh that 50% up on Rafa. And hope that this Swift spell can chain into the Roaming Warrior. Piss. Oh boy. Alright, we're fine. We're fine. In fact, we're gonna see how this... No, we can just Swift Spell, that's right. Yeah, that was a good choice. Nice, 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 nice. Alright, good. Hell yeah. Alright, Titan. Are you ready for the meltdown? Alright, so he's in this rough phase right now. So pretty much he's about to destroy me for my insolence and doing 60k damage that fast. Yeah, that seems about right. Rocks fall, everybody dies. Oh, end this, Ignis. What a fight. I say, I love those fights. They're so good. And just like, everything's happening at once. Alright, last fight of the set, the Immortal Souls. Doga and Une at the same time. A friend of mine who really likes the original FF3, plays it a ton, told me this is actually how the fight goes down in the original game. FF3, another game that I never actually played all the way through. But yeah, so Doga and Une come with their mechanics. Doga being very AoE focused, Une doing buffs. Une, though, aside from the buffs, being the more threatening one here because she has Holy, which you cannot debuff. Such, though, I brought a team involving dancers and the like. Ignis will be taunting with a natural reflect cast on him by Record Materia. Penelope will be dancing and also taunting right at the beginning. Just to make sure that those really spicy physical hits don't hit our front row people. There's not many of them, but they do exist. The one thing that I'm worried about with this setup here is I don't have a protect. We're going to see how that works out. They don't have a lot of physical hits. They have really two, aside from their standard attack that's pretty weak. But they're both AoE. But they're not likely to use them, so that's the thing. Lunith up top will be doing a lot of the big, long charge time moves. I'm actually kind of split whether to have him or Terra summon. Because Lunith could, you know, swift strike into those moves. So yeah. We're gonna see how this goes down. I actually don't have dual cast on Selfie this time around because I'm looking for a word here. Actually, the thing that she has on her isn't good, now that I think about it. Because we don't want an accidental dual cast to hit Ignis. We want him to be just not healing himself. Here we go, nice charge. Aside from that, we are going to take a Vessel of Fates, of course. Yeah, four Dark Guardians, here we go. No, honestly, I think Doga and Inoue makes the most sense, because they were the ones, you know, for taking the theming of this event. They were the ones that sealed Eureka. Oh, also, should emphasize this. The Banishing Blade on Ignis is to dispel any buffs thrown out by Une. Haste, obviously, high priority to get rid of. Though, if all Doga has is Protect, we can actually leave him alone for a bit. They can't cast a shell, so that's not going to stop Terra. Yeah, perfect. That's exactly what I want. That's exactly what I don't want. However, we do have to start taunting everything over, so the sooner we do that, the better. Now, of course, because this is a yeah, I kind of cut off abruptly there. I just had a very bad thought, and I need to actually confirm this, or deconfirm this. Drain is sometimes a physical move. Single opponent inborn. The fuck does inborn mean? Is it physical or magic? Alright, it's magic. That's insane amounts of damage. Also, yes, drain can't be reflected. Just crazy that that happened that way. Christ. Alright, so this full charge is going to do less damage, but there's really nothing that we can do to outthink that. Christ, I'm sorry? Hold the fucking phone. I'm doing a stopover at my research real quick. Yeah, Lunas took an 8,000 damage fucking drain. Here we go. That drain is forced. That happens every second turn. Okay. We do magic down dance first. Alright. You convinced me. Jesus Christ. They can't be more protected right now. Unless I was able to get full breakdance off first, but multi-break, but that's not gonna happen. Acceptable. There we go. Just delete those buffs. Yeah, Drain is not affected by magic lore. It's one of them spells. Fuck on. Oh boy. Alright, going a bit heavy in the AoEs, I see it, okay. There we go, that's more what I'm talking about. You can calm down a bit with those. In theory, this will be an easier fight once one of them is down. Yo, I think Ignis is gonna die. Yo! Come on, please just kill this. Oh, piss. The AoEs are so rough. It'll be fine. I think I might have been better off, maybe comboing Blood of the Weverin with Lightning Jump or something like that. Alright, you know, that's... I can deal with that. Oh, piss. Alright, good, that's not actually gonna go to Ignis. Full charge does more damage than, it's fine, you can keep that protect. Full charge does more damage than, lightning dive. Christ. You know, I complain, but every turn that he does, like, something like that instead of, you know, that is a turn I get to breathe. Gee, the bottom one is female. Nice. Oh, piss. So yeah, that's the problem with Une. I mean, we can effectively go for it, because if there's no major AoEs, he says, as that happens. Yeah. No, fuck it. Let's keep going. Oh, right. She's hasted. Or he's hasted. This way is extremely rough. A good bit of it is actually the annoyance of having to click in every command, every single time. Yo, frankly, I could swap out Pinello's record materia, because it's really just that first punch. That's the only one that matters. It's the only one that's taunting. It's not really doing that much for me. Oh, well, I guess that one too. Fuck. Resisted. Oh, piss, that's right. You think fucking... Somebody in the notes would have mentioned. Alright. Don't bring Titan. Well, you might swap her out for something else then. Yeah, but if the holy tags anybody. Really, that does go for if Unless you have wall, that holds true even without the reflect. What about without the reflect, though? A thought. But we'll try a crazy execution later. Yes, I am in fact thinking of running this with Carbuncle. No, running this with Carbuncle is an extremely bad idea. What if? I think a different ability in the second slot here is definitely a thing that might need to be changed big time. Titan is doing me no assistance. It hits for max damage on Une, but on Doga, not so much. And that's a dead. Valfor do all right damage, maybe. I'm thinking just like chain Thundaga. Let's see if Desh's sword buffs that. Nope. Feathered hat? Nope. Thank you. Oh, right. You're stupid. Why isn't the coral ring? Yeah. It's a bit much. Again, it's a shame because, like, I try and be prepared for these streams, and you know, you watch a video online, and they're like, ah, here's exactly how the fight goes down and all that. It's like, ah, yes, okay. Let me just write down in my notebook here. Reflect, taunt. Ah, yes, this works. Doesn't taunt. Holy. Holy resist. We'll see. We'll shelf that. That's a good point. Holy resist. Cause like the holy is an issue, but at the same time, like the AoE spells are also a big problem. This is a shitty start. Oh, Christ, that sucks. Thank you. little bit of extra damage. That's good. That's bad. That's alright. Which summons didn't take away my fucking commands. Christ. And that's that. He's like, putting holy resist accessories on is like, gather my thought for a second here. Putting holy resist accessories on is like, then you're rolling the dice against, like, come on, big money, no AoE attacks. Take those single target hits. Alright, it's fine, it's just power charge going off. Power chain. Still, it's wasted damage. I hate that. I just kill Une. Funny, you know, I took chain starter full charge because, or power charge full charge because it was like, yeah, this is a good combo, so we'll get some real good moves off. And it's like, oh, wait, I have to wait. Ugh. Thank you. We're in holy territory now. No! Piss. Destroyed! He has less health. Aiden is putting some work, you're not doing anything. Okay, uh-oh. He's angry. Is it self-KO? Alright, so as long as we don't lose a point for actions, and or only lose one for damage, this is good. Or fuck it. Fuck it, I was fine. So yeah, I think that kind of shows, you need a Medica, because they throw out a lot of AoE damage, and as long as you don't get hit by that Holy is kind of a death sentence. Those are the two big things. Jesus Christ, though. My throat was killing me for like half that fight. Hold up, I need to take a sip of water. Okay, I know I said a sip, but I just drank half the goddamn bottle. We saw the accessory, but let's just take a quick peep at that again. Moderate wind resistance is actually pretty good for that fight. Anywho, that's it for the FF3 event. Yeah, the duo was kind of rough, actually. Made it by the skin of my teeth. Next week, we have FF8 again. That ultimate, double plus, also is going to be quite rough, so I'll see you then.